Great Scott!
The Great Scott Show.
And as they head into the final furlong, all of the other radio stations and radio hosts are left in the wake of a keen turn of speed by the Great Scott Show, the champion!
With Scott Prather.
Steal the show.
Hello, everybody. Welcome into the Great Scott Show. Happy to have you with me. Only four more hours left of this. Two today, two tomorrow. What better way to spend a Thursday morning than in a unlicensed, unofficial therapist role, because James Butler is here, former UL and NFL wide receiver, state trooper. Despite what he says, friend, and he is in studio for the next 2 hours, and I'm sure he's feeling, you know, he comes in here and he's just a just an array of emotions every time.
That's not true, man.
You will go from just like on cloud nine to just complete disarray in a matter of like minutes, depending on what I say or depending on how I respond to you saying things about sports. And that's makes it fun. So good morning, man.
Because you're negative sometimes.
I'm not negative.
You know what? I think
I'm not negative.
A perfect example of this is what we talked about last show when the Saints lost the game against the Bucks, and I text you.
Hey, right, like, we're going to do this again?
Yeah, and I was like, hey, man, like, you know. And then you read the text messages, because I was trying to, I told people on air that, you know, I text you, you didn't text me back. Like,
which wasn't true.
You left me hanging, and then you went through the text messages and was like, you sent me five messages before I could.
Yeah, in the matter of like 1 minute. You said, bam, 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 bam. And I couldn't even read them all, because some of them had some choice language in them. You were like, distraught, and I did respond. I mean, look, that's the thing. You're so used to this role of being like the patient, but in some of those moments where you're texting me, we're not in the studio. Like I still get upset. I mean, I would when the Saints blew that game to the Bucks on Monday night. I mean, I was livid.
You were just
in your own feelings, and you were like, you need to be there for me right now. I'm like, what about me?
Yeah,
nah, I'm mad, man. Too.
Yeah, I'm not going to lie, that was one of the, like, the best moments on this show, I believe. Like, cause it was so funny because I was telling everybody on air that, like, you didn't text me back. Like,
I had the receipts, but
it was the messages that you read. It was like, mm-hmm. Hey, man, like, I'm hurt right now. Like, I need to go for a walk.
Yeah, that was it.
I don't think I can watch another game.
Yeah, all of these things that were very in the moment. Oh, and you were like, I didn't say all that. I was like, I showed you the phone. I'm like, that's you. That's your number.
Oh, man. You know what we should have did, too, though? We should have called your friend.
Oh.
The one that got abducted. We should have called him.
Gosh. It would be so weird if I just texted him. No, I can't. I don't.
Come on, man. This is the last one, man.
I can't text him. Out of the blue. I haven't talked to him in like probably a month or two. I can't be like, hey, you want to come on my radio show right now and talk about being abducted? I can't do that.
You said that he knew that you joked about it. Don't put
no,
me in
no.
that.
I,
that
I,
you joked about he, it.
When I saw him in November, I let him. I alerted him to the fact that it was brought up on the show because I didn't mention his name, but that I had a friend in New Orleans East that was abducted. And, you know, I said, I had this co-host who's a state trooper, and instead of, you know, having empathy or sympathy, he just started laughing on the air.
We already established why, man.
We're circling back to old territory.
Well, what is there new to talk about? Like, Kevin Durant?
there are a lot of things happening in the world of sports,
Kevin Durant,
James.
Like, we don't care. Like, what that means?
All right, we are going to get into Kevin Durant in a moment.
The Lakers.
And we're going to talk NBA and Super Bowl and all that. I do want to ask you something about your former NFL teammate.
Oh, I know where this is going. Aaron Rodgers, isn't it?
Aaron Rodgers is not going to South America to do ayahuasca or whatever it's called.
Yes, he is.
No. He is going to go on a darkness retreat. Now, if you just heard darkness retreat, and do you even know what that is? By the way, have So what? When you hear someone's going on a darkness retreat, what do you think?
I think about meditation. That's what I think. That's immediately what I thought when I heard it. I didn't look into it. I just said, he's about to go.
Well, yeah, sure. I mean, a four-day darkness retreat. I mean, any kind of retreat essentially would be meditation.
Right.
But, like, the term darkness, like, what is that?
Sounds scary if you think about it, like, if you put it that way.
Aaron Rodgers,
like facing your demons,
his darkness retreat is pretty much what what it sounds like. He says it's to expand his mind. Good for him. Like many non-Judeo-Christian religions in the U.S., this kind of thing has been commercialized. As much as Rodgers wants to make ayahuasca or whatever it's called, or darkness retreats, a just thing for him. They've been happening for a number of years from, various groups. He basically just goes in a dark house for like 4 days and just does nothing. Just is by himself in darkness, no electricity, nothing. Just it's like going on a silent retreat religions do this too. You go into the woods for like a number of days and you pray or you reflect, but when you throw darkness in there and, a house and all the lights out,
But why do we need to know that? Like, why do we need
because
to know?
Because Aaron Rodgers likes to tell people these things.
Like, we don't need to know. You could have just said, I'm going to take time and reflect and then go to the darkness retreat. I feel like you telling us that to, like, create this narrative or, like, give us a story to talk about.
I mean, this is your friend. He gave you ride in his truck.
I talked to him the other day.
Well, really? What did he say?
I said, man, why don't you, why don't
he was like,
through?
Who is this?
That's not what he said. He knows exactly who I am.
Who is this? Am I dreaming? Is this real?
No.
Since I took that LSD, things are trippy right now.
Yeah. Yeah. When I gave him a ride.
James Butler, the basketball player for the
year. Oh, nah, man.
Oh, wait, you gave him a ride?
Yeah, I gave him a ride.
Oh, I thought he gave you a ride.
Nah, I gave him a ride.
Was he hitchhiking? He would be like, I'm just going to go hitchhike, the country, and come back and make a decision.
Nah,
I didn't know
man.
You gave him a ride.
Yeah, I gave him a ride.
Okay.
Nah, I didn't give a ride.
That's not what happened.
Nah, he gave me a ride, though. But nah, all seriousness, though, I called him the other day, man. I was like, why don't you come through? You know what I'm saying? Like,
trying to get him on the show.
We need a quarterback,
Oh, you're trying to get him in New Orleans.
Like, why don't you come through? He's like, man, I just need to figure some things out.
Yeah, I need to go on a darkness retreat. According to Hermitage Retreats, which has put on darkness retreats since 2015, attendees are placed in a locked, dark cabin for a predetermined amount of time. There is unlimited water, but the only food made available are two vegan meals provided through a two-way box in the door.
What?
When you watch a show or a movie and they're in prison and they just have like a little slot and you just like drop some food through?
So can you like is it like literally dark? Can you like read or something?
No. It's just dark.
So you
there's
can't
no
read?
And there's unlike a Buddhist or a Christian religion or something, there's not a focus on religious enlightenment, but it's the focus is on detoxing.
So you can't read?
No. It's just very vague.
You don't have your phone or nothing. You don't have your phone. You can't read.
It's not traditional therapy.
Is anyone else in there with you?
No.
So you're in there by yourself?
Yeah.
For like 4 days?
Mm-hmm.
By yourself, can't read, can't talk to anyone.
I don't know exactly what a dark retreat does, but I was hoping you could enlighten us.
You want me to call him and ask him?
Yeah. Yeah.
And what if he's already in there and I can't ask him?
He's going to emerge from this apparently with an answer about his future. He really, like, it's so different that it does become kind of just like a joke, and we like laugh about it. But Aaron Rodgers truly, like, if you had told us, you know, years ago, oh, there's going to be a multi-time MVP quarterback, and here are the things he's going to do each offseason, we'd be like, that's not real.
Right.
Like, that sounds like some, like, sketch comedy or something. Like, no, he's not going to go, you know, do some weird drugs on a beach with friends and then, you know, decide he wants to play football or go on, like, a darkness retreat.
That's weird to me. Like, but my whole thing is, why even advertise that? Like, you don't even have to advertise that.
Right.
You could have just said, I'm going to make my decision and went on the, like, I honestly believe he said that to, like, create this narrative that he's, like, so different than everyone else.
I think he's into this stuff. Like, I don't think he's putting this on, but I think he does like the attention despite the fact saying he doesn't. You know what I mean?
That's weird.
And I'm sure I was just reading stuff online. I'm sure there's a lot more to it than that.
I'm going to call him
but an to pay to just go be in a dark cabin without, you know, a lot of food for.
So you want me to see if he's going to be the Saints quarterback, and would you accept?
Oh, sure. Like, if he wants to be the Saints quarterback, yes, absolutely.
You would accept that?
Dude, he can go whatever treat he wants. He can do all the ayahuasca he wants. It's fine.
So you would take Aaron Rodgers as Saints quarterback?
Yeah, would you?
I don't know.
Oh, stop it.
I don't know, man.
You would take Aaron Rodgers next season?
I don't know. What's available?
No one better than that.
Give me some options. Give me some options.
Your Jameis Winston, who you said would win the MVP this year. Stop. All right. You know what? We need to take a break. This is ridiculous.
Why is it not real? Why is it not real?
Just
I can't give you a real answer. And then so I give you a real answer, then now you're like saying that's like.
Give me. You say you're going to give me a real answer.
That is a real answer.
No, why? Give me a reason, a real reason.
A reason? Because I told you, man, like if he would never got hurt, you know.
That's not a reason.
That is a reason.
No, that's
if he wouldn't have got hurt.
Just a ridiculous. Like belief,
that's not a ridiculous. All right, belief.
Finish the sentence. If he wouldn't have gotten hurt,
the man was 5-2. Okay, before, okay,
but that's not.
He hurt his
finish
knee.
Finish the sentence you were about to say.
No,
you're about to say you were going to be the MVP. We're playing in the Super Bowl this week.
Is that far fetched?
Yes,
no, it's not.
Yes.
No, it's not.
Yes,
no, it's not.
Yes,
it's not far fetched.
Yes, it is.
It's not because we were 5-2. Before he tore his knee.
Let me ask you something. Let's not do this again. How much would you have to be paid to go on a darkness retreat like this one?
Nothing, actually. I mean, if you tell me, like, spiritually, it will really help me.
Does she think, like, well, who's telling you that?
Like, that's what I'm saying. Like, I don't know. Like, I don't know who to talk to about this. But if someone that I, like, look up to spiritually.
Yeah, like your friend Aaron.
Come on, man. I guess, man. If me and Aaron were like really close friends, and Aaron told me, "Hey, man, I see you have some things you need to work through. Here's what I suggest." Then I would
go in this dark cabin, pay a lot of money to go in a dark cabin.
I would have
for
to
four
respect
days,
him as a
no
man.
Light, no light at all. We'll pass you a few vegan meals through a little drop box, and you can have some water.
Listen, Aaron can't tell me this as just Aaron. I would have to respect him spiritually.
So are you saying you don't respect your friend?
Spiritually? I don't know where his heart is spiritually. As a football player, yeah. But spiritually, I would have
apparently
to.
You don't respect him as a football player. You just said you would take Jameis Winston next season over Aaron Rodgers.
Is Aaron Rodgers on the Saints right now?
You didn't. That's not. The,
is he on the Saints right now?
You're circling
but
back.
Is he on the Saints right now?
No,
no, he's not.
You said you would take him for you. Then you said, all right, well, give me some players. I said I'd take him for you. It's like, give me some players, I'd take him over.
But that's hypothetical, though.
I know. Saying, this whole thing is hypothetical.
No, it's not because James is on the team right now.
No, it's not. He's not going to be on the team.
But he's on the team.
Answer
right now.
The question. So you're suggesting that if you could have next season as the Saints' starting quarterback,
who's most likely to be on the team?
That's
next
not
season?
The question.
But this is the same thing.
No, it's not. It's not even close to the same thing.
How?
No, that's like asking me, do you want $1 million or do you want, you know, $3 in your bank account?
Well, which one am I closer to? I want a million,
but which one is reality? You know, what's really in your bank account? Those are two different questions.
But that's
James.
Literally the same thing.
No, it's not even close to the same thing.
My bank account is closer to the $3.
Yes, but that's different than me saying, would you prefer to have $1 million or $3?
What's more realistic?
That's the different question. See, it's funny that you're trying to spin the wheels, but I'm the one that's realistic about these teams, and you claim that I'm a hater when I'm the one that's objective, and now I'm actually asking you a question that you would ask, and you won't even answer it.
I didn't answer it.
If in this hypothetical question, as the Saints starting quarterback in 2023,
okay,
would you take Aaron Rodgers or would you take Jameis Winston?
What is the circumstance?
That's it. No circumstance. No strings attached.
No strings attached?
That's it.
Hmm.
Don't do it.
Let me think.
Don't do it.
Hmm. What's the situation? Like, do we still have Sean Payton?
Is it
what's going on right now with the team?
It's the current team that next season will have one or the other.
Hmm.
What, do you need to go on a darkness retreat to figure this out?
Come on. I might have to, bro.
Stop it.
I might have to, because who's to say Aaron Rodgers is going to get along with the Saints teammates? Oh, like, who's to say that? I have to think about these names. We have a culture that we're trying to...
A culture that wasn't too good last year.
Okay, well, look, we're trying to get better. He can make it worse. So I stick with my answer. I'm sticking with James.
Oh, my.
Sorry,
I really believe these things.
I do. I apologize.
You really? What are you apologizing for?
Because obviously,
it's so ridiculous.
You're like upset at me because of my answer. Because you're for some reason you think that my answer isn't valid. Like I can't have an opinion. And there's people out there that agree with me. Actually,
really?
Yep.
So no strings attached. Aaron Rodgers or Jameis Winston for a season. We have no way to prove this, but what percentage of individuals would you estimate would agree with you on this?
Are you trying to, like, create a poll to see?
No, I just want your opinion.
At least, like, 75%. At least 75 people.
Oh, my God.
75% of the people, they agree with what I'm
saying.
You
and I have a better chance of going on a darkness retreat next year than either of those guys being the quarterback.
I'm really going to look into this now. Like, when we leave here, I'm going to look into this whole darkness retreat thing.
What do you need to look at? I can send you the information.
Because I'm just curious, like, what exactly is supposed to be done? Like,
there is some, according to this website, there is some scientific evidence a person can see visions while in sensory deprivation due to the Ganzeld effect.
Okay.
Where the brain, when deprived of visual stimuli after receiving it for an extended period of time, amplifies neural noise in an attempt to amplify visual signals.
Okay. Well.
So, essentially, you start seeing things.
So, would you do it, though?
Absolutely not. No, I'm not going to do
it. How much would they have to pay you to do it?
A lot.
Like, if someone that you respected spiritually, that you look for.
There are people I respect spiritually, and I go places where they send me. Okay. And I do go on retreats, but they wouldn't suggest a darkness retreat.
But how you know? Like, what if they
I'm Roman Catholic. I've been on silent retreats before, but not a darkness retreat.
What if the priest said, look, Scott, I think.
If this was totally different and there was a Christian Catholic element to it?
Yeah.
But there's not.
But I'm saying, see, this is what we literally just had the conversation with the whole. This is not the same thing.
Not even close to the same thing.
Because I'm asking
Listen,
you.
The answer remains no. There are some.
So you wouldn't do it? Like if the priest said, listen, man, like I think you. That's not right.
No, I wouldn't do it.
That's not right.
There are different. Have you been on retreats in your life?
I don't know. Have I? I got to think.
Why are you asking me?
I don't know. I got to think.
There are different kinds of retreats, and you know, depending on your personality and where you are, you respond differently at these retreats. So some are more fitting for you than others. For Rodgers, it's drugs on a beach and a darkness retreat. That's just not my thing.
Your favorite priest of all time.
My favorite priest of all time.
Said that you have to go.
That I have
he's
to.
He's suggesting that you that go to the doctor's
sure,
retreat.
Sure.
Would you go?
Sure.
All right, that's the only thing I wanted.
But that's not what the darkness retreat is, James.
Oh, man.
It's not.
I get that. But I'm just saying, if he suggested you to go, would you go?
Sure.
All right, so that's, I mean.
That's that's just ridiculous.
That's what I'm saying. Like,
that's so ridiculous.
That's all I'm saying.
Like, no, but that's not.
How? How is that ridiculous? That,
because it's not, like, based in anything factual.
So you literally just sat up here and told me that the answer I gave about James Winston wasn't factual when he's literally on the team.
We're on a sports show, and you know he's going to be released, and it's a simple sports question. It's going to happen.
How you know that? You don't know that.
I do.
You don't?
Yes, I do.
No, you don't. How you know that?
Because I know people.
You know people?
Yeah.
I know people, too.
I know people.
I know people, too.
I know people that follow this team closely and have sources. He's not. He's got, I mean, nothing against James. He's not on the team next year, James.
How you know that?
I know.
Like, you don't, like, give me, like, a percentage that he's not on the team next year.
100.
Okay. Okay. All right. That's fine. That's cool.
You want to go into a darkness retreat and start, you know, having visions and hallucinations. That's the thing. Rodgers is very big on hallucinations. And I'm not judging him. He feels like in these states that he experiences that they give him answers. And, you know, it was ayahuasca. I think the year before was a cleansing thing where for like 11 days it was like,
right,
you know, and then you read about this and it's like, well, this is not, you know, something that I'm into. But, hey, good for him.
I have a serious question. And I promise you this is not a joke, okay? I promise you. Like, back in the day, it was well-known knowledge that Aaron Rodgers, why are you laughing already?
I'm not laughing. You're giggling.
It was well-known knowledge that he did not have a good relationship with his family.
Mm-hmm.
Now that he's doing all these things, the retreats, the cleansing, does he have a better relationship with his family? It's still no?
To my knowledge, the answer is no. He is still estranged from his family.
So what is the point? Like,
well, I
thought you were doing these things to be a better person.
I don't know. He never said he was doing it to be a better person. He says he's doing it, and he'll have an answer about his career when he comes out.
Well, you
out
need
of
to
it.
Have an answer about your family. That's the most
I'll never
important
forget
thing.
Michael Irvin. I mean, Michael Irvin, he hams it up for the cameras. I mean, I think we can all agree that, right?
Yeah.
And Kurt Warner is, you know, more your straight lace, you know, kind of just factual.
Right.
And they were talking about, you know, is Aaron Rodgers going to be traded? Is he going to go to another team? Is he going to stay? Is he going to retire? Is he going to go host Jeopardy? And I don't know, Kurt was giving a very good quarterback answer. And then they brought up, you know, what about locker room? And he's like, you know, his teammates seem to like him. And, you know, but what about management? And they go to Urban. And he's like, that man, he hates his mom. I don't trust him. And he just kept saying over and over, that man, he don't care about his mom.
Like
he don't care about his Kurt. And Kurt's sitting there and he's just kind of like, you know, Michaels, he's got the rag out and he's like wiping the sweat off his brow. That he don't like his mama.
Yeah.
And I was like, I could watch this interaction all day. It was great.
And this man, he don't care about his mama, but you want him on the Saints, please.
I mean, for a season, sure, yeah.
Come on, man.
Be the quarterback. I mean, I hate to tell you, James, I hate to bring up, you know, Drew Brees sued his mom.
No, he did not.
Yes, he did.
Did he really?
Yes.
For what?
Just Google it. To say that, you know, because someone doesn't get along with their mom, they can't be the quarterback. That would be like you saying
is
you just
real?
Want to wipe away all the Drew. That is real.
I didn't hear about that.
Well,
for what?
Well, open your mind. And in all sincerity, I you know, we're getting our jokes off about a darkness retreat. I hope that Aaron does, you know, make amends with his family. I think it's sad when people are estranged from their family.
Wow.
Yeah, and then his mom, a few years later, committed suicide, and he wrote about it in his book a little bit. It was some, you know, that's some difficult stuff.
Yo, I did not know this.
Yeah. Well, you do now. So does this change your mind on whether Aaron Rodgers be the quarterback next season?
No, it does not change my mind. But I didn't know that about the whole, like,
Well, you have to. Then, okay, well, you at least have to acknowledge to that comment, you know, that somehow someone couldn't be a quarterback because they have issues with their family. Is that was a bit, you know, you were throwing a large umbrella over a whole situation. And
did any of Drew Brees' teammates ever come out and say they didn't like him? That he was hard to work with?
Who said that about Rodgers?
A lot of people.
Greg Jennings, maybe once. Who else? I mean, you didn't say you played with him.
I ain't gonna lie, he was cool to me though.
Yeah, see, like, you know what I mean? His teammates, you. I love how we're sitting here. You were literally one of his teammates, and like, you like him.
Nah, he was cool to me.
Love that. You're literally like, that's what's lost in all this. You're like, man, a bunch of teammates. I'm like, who? You're like, I mean, you know, some people did. You know,
did I come back? Nah, he was cool to me. Nah, he was cool to me though.
We're gonna. James comes in. I don't even know how we got here. 25 after the hour. We got to take a break. Former UL and Green Bay Packer wide receiver James Butler, former teammate of Aaron Rodgers. Man gave you a ride in his truck, and you're out here, you know.
He was cool, man.
Judging him for his family. You don't know what his family's like. You don't know what they did or didn't do.
Talked to me on the field a few times.
A
few times. You know, coached me up.
Whenever he got you in his truck, did he try to get you to do like LSD or anything?
Nah, man. He was just asking me about like,
drink this, you'll see visions. that's, you'll be able to work in this offense.
That's peer pressure.
I know.
I ain't gonna lie. Like if Aaron Rodgers told me to do it,
he probably would have done it.
I probably would have done it.
Like this will assure your spot on the roster. Like, James would have been like, "Give me that dude," and gulped it down.
Man. Hey man, look, don't tell me what it is. But
all I know is, if you had done that today, you would not be sitting here. You would be in some cabin in Siberia getting vegan meals through a slot and paying a lot of money for that.
That's true. But is that such a bad thing, though? Is the question.
I guess it just depends on who you ask. We'll be right back. Don't go anywhere. It's the Great Scott Show. That's James. I'm Scott, 103.3 The GOAT, simulcast on 1420.
It's a good thing goats have four stomachs. Otherwise, there's no way we could swallow some of these takes.
Hey, goat, what's going on out there?
103.3 The GOAT, the greatest sports talk of all time.
All right, welcome back into the Great Scott Show. James Butler over there looking at his phone. What's the Twitter handle, James?
I really don't know.
Okay. I didn't even wait till the end of the show.
I really don't know what it is.
It's Jimmy B 1183, right?
Yeah, that's what it
is. See, I didn't even look it up, and I knew it. Come on. Mike Bernard's in here, the bandit.
The bandit.
He wanted to ask you something, James. Mike, what did you want to ask? He drove in here this morning to ask you a question.
Okay.
Face to face.
I did?
Yeah. Yeah. What did you want to ask him? That's what he told me. He texted me. He's like, I'm coming in. I got a bone to pick.
No, he's lying.
All right. I made that up.
That's cool.
I mean, nice to meet him, you know, but he played with Aaron Rodgers. I don't know. I kind of trust his judgment.
By saying
he's a great quarterback, Scott, but he sounds like Ricky Williams right now.
Ricky Williams was a great player.
Yeah, but he lived in a tent for a while.
Hey, what's wrong with that? You know?
Okay.
Nothing wrong with that.
I don't know, man. You just seems like a... We'll see.
You wouldn't take him for one season with the Saints?
You like Derek Carr?
I mean, I'd take him over Jameis.
Would you?
You asked me that question before the season.
Oh, I did.
Remember that?
I got a question for James.
No, I don't think Derek Carr is going to fix
your
problems.
Why didn't they play Jameis this year? You think?
He was hurt.
You think so?
I think so.
But he came on and he said he wasn't.
I don't.
No, he was. He said he was healthy enough to play.
Yeah, I think he was still hurt. That's what he said. Yeah. Because I heard he was still rehabbing or something like that. That's what I heard.
Yeah, his foot was still messed up. My theory is that they should not have played him against Tampa Bay and Carolina, but I don't know if there was like they realized like we might have screwed up so bad on that we could be liable for something if we put him back out there.
Right.
I don't know. It seemed like there was a little more to all that. But
when I went to the Ravens game and watched him warm up, it looked like he was still moving awkwardly.
Yeah, his foot was messed up. It wasn't just a, you know, pain everywhere, pain all over, you know.
So I think he was still hurt, you know.
Gotcha. All right. That was all. You see, you drove in here just to ask him that, Mike?
I came to tell you. Come on, man. You know how long you been here? You helped me a lot, bro.
I let me tell y'all quick.
In stations and
let me tell y'all a quick Bandit story, and it's nice of you to come in, Mike. Before we let Mike go.
I just
go.
Want to tell one story before.
Oh, okay. All right. All right. Leave, so he did. No, all right. No, go ahead. Okay. The floor is yours.
You sure?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. You won't remember this. First time met you. I believe me and Big Dave were here maybe a year or two before you got here. I'm not sure. But you were at a radio station in New Orleans.
I remember.
And you would host a high school.
Mike,
like,
you're not going to believe this. I talked about that yesterday and brought you up that I talked to you
I
on
must
the phone.
Have been in a shower.
No, it wasn't on the radio.
Oh.
No, I didn't bring that up on the radio. But, yeah, no, I remember talking to you on the phone for the Nokia Sugar Bowl prep football roundup.
So okay. Big Dave and I were there, and we would go, and I couldn't go on every 20 minutes because we were broadcasting. But I'd go interview the coach. Now, we quit when we got a sideline reporter. Mm-hmm. But we would go on the field, and I'd go grab the coach. And I'd interview him, and one night I just called into the number and it says, "Yeah, this is Scott Prather." Mm-hmm. He was the studio host, and I said, "Damn!" And then when he came, I said, "Dude, you remember me, man? Yeah. I called you." But and then Dave started saying one night it was about to turn off the lights at the stadium because I had to go back up and pack all the stuff after we'd sign off, and he said, "We ain't doing that no more. They ain't paying you." I'm like. But it gave me a shirt. It gave me a watch, you know. You know, it's not that bad.
Dave's like, we're about to be on a darkness retreat. We got to get out of here.
Right.
Yeah, I remember what that show was is it was you just call stringers. So you would, for hours, for like 5 hours.
You were
hours.
A stringer?
No, I was the producer in the studio.
Yeah.
You were a stringer, Mike. You were a stringer. Everyone that we called.
Oh, I was the stringer for y'all.
Yeah, so you'd call people across the state at high school games, and they would give an update on what was happening, okay. And then the game would end.
I'd show up at an LSU game.
Sometimes they would have they'd have a coach.
Man, I heard you on the radio last night. I'm like, oh, yeah, you heard the game we did? No, I heard you on the – I'm like, damn.
And we'd introduce someone. We'd be like, hey, you know, we're going to James Butler. He's at Lutcher versus –
right.
You know, Academy Christian, James, what's happening there? And we would laugh because every time we go to Mike, we would say, and most of the time we'd be like, hey guys, yeah, the score is this. You'd say, we'd introduce him, we'd say, this is Mike Bernard. He is down in Acadiana for STM versus Northside. Mike, what's going on? And Mike would say, yeah, this is Mike Bernard of the No Gift. you would say your name right after we introduced you every single time. And so it became a thing where we're like, I bet he's going to do it. I bet he's going to do it.
Oh, all right. So, well, now y'all.
So you were memorable, right? Like, I
we had that St. Martinville and St. Thomas More. And what was funny was you went to St. Thomas More.
Yeah.
And then, I don't know if you talked to Coach Hightower, you told him hi.
And you would be like, Scott praises us. I'd be like, oh, okay, that's weird. It's weird. Tell him hi.
Yeah, man.
Yeah.
So I'd introduce, okay, well.
Well, yeah, the big time sports.
I never went to broadcast school.
No, it was, most of those stringers didn't. It was fun, man.
How long did you do that?
I remember that.
Year, 2 years?
I just did that for a year.
Yeah.
It's one of the things I did over there, yeah. Let's go out to Mike Bernard, Nokia Sugar Bowl Prep Football Roundup. Yeah, this is Mike Bernard, Nokia Sugar Bowl Prep Football Roundup.
You should have told me something.
No, I mean, I didn't know you. I just was like, this is great. And we didn't, for the record, Mike, we never, like, the guys that hosted the show wouldn't point that out on the air. It was just a thing that we remembered.
Yeah, yeah.
In the studio.
Off the air.
Yeah, correct. We're like, he's going to.
Why are you going to say his name again?
Double intro. You know, hey, that's what makes you more memorable, right? They tell you in radio, repeat the station name when you're doing an interview, repeat. So you were actually doing it the right way.
Say the score.
Yeah.
There was an emotional game one time. I don't remember what had happened. There was some kind of tragedy where I guess a player had died earlier that season. I didn't know you, but we went out to him, and you were saying to the players, this is before you were on the air over there. And this, bear in mind, this is at This would air on WWL, so you could hear this thing.
Okay.
All over the place.
Okay.
And you were caught up in the moment. You were like, I don't know what to say. You know, I'm not sure what to say. You know, I don't think I can do it. And I remember like kind of talking you through it. I'm like, just do your best, you know. And we went to him, and he said, this is Mike Bernard of the Nokia Sugar Bowl Prep Football Roundup.
We have our football banquet's going to be coming up, and we named a few awards after kids, like, either passed away or made it to the NFL. And we have, like, the Jake DeLome Award, the Kevin Falk Award.
Okay.
We have the Travis Landry Award. He was a linebacker at Cecilia, died in a car accident.
Okay.
You know, different things like that.
Right.
But, yeah, they've had a few over the years. We had funny situations.
Well, no, it's been great getting to know you, Mike, and obviously our friend, the late great Big Dave Thibodeau. Man, he left a mark for sure, and it's been awesome that you've kept that show going and kept that community going.
I was worried at first, but it worked out, I guess.
Yeah, come on, man. Never forget that.
Still
that,
rolling.
That first Sunday show after David passed, man. Ooh, that was
rough.
That was
man. This whole studio was packed. Yeah. In fact, it was so packed the door was open, and we had people flooding into the. You might have had 8 people here.
Yeah.
Jay, you.
It was something, man.
Yeah.
It was something. Well, all the best, man.
It's been
awesome, and look forward to listening to Big Time Sports Talk. That's Mike Bernard. They call him the Bandit.
Sorry for interrupting you. Sure.
No, it's all right. You wanted to ask.
Nice to meet you.
You wanted to ask James something, man. He texts me all the time. He's like, who is this guy? I got to see what he's like. That's him, Mike. He's right there. He didn't think you were real. He thought you were just some made-up character.
That's a...
I'm kidding.
Because of the stuff
kidding,
I say.
Maybe. I mean, you know, a lot of the stuff you say is pretty unbelievable, dude.
Well, it's not, man. Says who?
I mean,
it says you. You're the only person that think that.
Dude, come on. That's not true. I mean, we get.
If you open up the phone lines right now, I guarantee you.
Phone lines are open.
They're going to side with me.
337-269-1077. There don't need to be sides here, man. We're, you know, we're in this together.
No, we're not in this together.
Well, why not?
No, we're not. You're not going to do that to me.
Do what?
Because you're playing it now to where, like, now we're on the same side. We're not. And you know we're not because you're disagreeing with what I'm saying.
Yeah, but that doesn't mean we're not on the same side.
So now you're trying to be on my side now because you know they're going to call in and
about what?
Me, and they're not going to side with you. That's
about what?
About this whole thing. Like, anything that I talk about. Anything? Everything that I talked about on this show has been real. And has been the truth.
First of all, you've come on here and we established the last time you were on that you were
wrong.
You were that you were lying about the
lying about what?
Saying that I didn't text you back and all that other stuff.
I couldn't remember that.
No, you were lying. You were accusing me. And then when you thought that this song was Eazy E, and then you asked if it was Eazy E. And then you denied it.
I did not do
that. See, now you're lying again.
I did not do that.
We'll be right back. It's the Great Scott Show, 103.3 The Goat, simulcast on 1420.
And you can feel what I'm feeling, and it's a musical masterpiece. Hear what I'm dealing with, and that's cool at least. What's running through my mind comes through my walk.
103.3 The Goat.
I don't care how fast you are or how big you are. Somebody's going to be faster and somebody's going to be bigger.
The greatest sports talk of all time.
Buckle up, boys. Time to go to work.
103.3 The Goat.
What are you saying?
Oh, you checkies and TV addicts. Don't mean to diss, don't mean to bring
static. There it is. Your Super Bowl halftime performer. That's Rihanna coming out of the break.
Is it really?
No.
I think I know Rihanna.
No.
I think I know.
I don't know, man. The funniest thing about the EZ comment way back when was that I just let it slide. I was like, I'm not going to put this man on blast. But all of your coworkers were listening, and they seem to have gotten a kick out of that.
That never happened, so I don't even know what you're talking about.
You can't just erase history, James.
It didn't happen.
You got on a hoodie that says good sense. Have some good sense.
Do you know who that is? This rapper named Young Roddy from New Orleans. That's his label, Good Sense. I know you never heard of him. So
I haven't. Is he good?
He's pretty good.
Should I check it out?
He used to run with Currency and You don't know what currency is?
I've heard the name. He spells it, and he's got like a little like money sign in it. Yeah. But if you played it, I couldn't tell you like, oh, that's currency.
All right. But he's a sponsor for the Pelicans.
Oh, that dude. Okay. Yeah, I see him. I see him on. Okay. All right. Yeah,
that's what currency is. The Jet Life and.
All right. You wanted to open up phone lines. Phone lines are open. 337-269-1077. James Butler is in studio. I mean, I'm here trying to help you out with therapy. We haven't even gotten into the KD stuff or anything else. Derek Carr.
It doesn't scare me. The whole KD thing.
All right. Let's go to the phone lines. Good morning. Welcome into the show.
Scott?
Yes.
I listen to you every morning. I play college football. I know sports. But I'm going to tell you what. You two guys together, y'all need to take this show on the road. Y'all are hilarious. I mean, this guy, Butler, I mean, I know him from watching him on TV. But, I mean, y'all play off each other. I'd rather watch y'all on Monday Night Football than the Mannings.
I appreciate that, man.
What would we call that? The what cast? I don't know what we'd call it, man. We could just call it good sense, you know.
Oh, that's tight.
But we'll put it like sense, like C-E-N-T-S. That's like tight, man. We don't make money like the Mannings. We just make pennies. But that's you know tight, what? Man. Good sense.
That's tight.
Bro, y'all are great together, and I wish you'd have him on more because I enjoy it. I listen to you every morning when I'm bringing my grandson to school.
Y'all
are hilarious together.
I really appreciate that, man. Thanks for listening all these years. And, you know, the thing I miss most about the job is coming on and doing this show and, you know, trying to help James through some tough times. You know what I mean?
I want you to say something for me, though. Gerald Broussard?
Yeah. What about G?
Yeah, I played at McNeese, and I played 4 years against him, and we never lost to USL.
Oh man, you're just cutting G deep right now.
Cut him off at the knees. I remember when we came to play, they were undefeated in conference, and we were undefeated, and every overpass from Jennings to Lafayette had a sign on it, go to hell, McNeese. It was awesome.
Oof. Man, that was smart, dude, because you buttered up James. You made him feel good about himself, and then you started, you know, ripping into his alma mater, and suddenly he looked at me like, I get this guy out of here.
Yeah, man.
So that was good. That was good.
I'm sorry, Joe.
This is the greatest school, man. I can't take any slander. This is the greatest school.
I support him. I support him.
I appreciate that, man. I really do.
Thanks for the call. But,
you know, that was a huge rivalry back in the day.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yep.
Thank y'all.
I appreciate it, man. Thank you.
Want to report, if I could be serious for a minute, there is pretty bad traffic accidents in the area.
Where?
I-49 southbound. The left lane is closed at exit 4 due to a 4-vehicle crash.
Okay.
That's over there. That's per the Carenco police.
That's Carenco. That
accident happened at 7:30. There is a vehicle accident in Youngsville over by Youngsville Highway and Fortune Road at 7:30. Vehicle accident on Hector Connolly Road in northeast Evangeline Thruway. Accident at southeast Evangeline Thruway and Louisiana Avenue. And a vehicle accident at 139 Turlings Drive. So be careful out there, guys.
All of them are like pretty bad accidents?
I don't know, but they all either have police or sheriff assisting right now. I don't know about the severity of it, but I do know a lot of traffic is being rerouted. So maybe you end up hearing James and I for a little longer this morning because your commute's a little longer. But be careful out there. Be careful.
Yeah, please. I just worked a bad one kind of like that.
Yeah. I mean, you, James, being a state trooper, do you get stressed like even when you're not on the clock when you hear about four or five cop pileups?
It just happened. Like, I was like, are you serious right now? Because it was kind of like, it's so much that goes into that, man. Like, if you could, like, ride with me for a day and you could see.
Could we film it? Could we make it? Could we make content out of it illegally?
Yeah. No, legally, man. Like, you know. Yeah.
It would be cool?
Yeah.
They wouldn't mind.
I mean, we have to go through the proper channels.
Dude, could you imagine if I end up with you and you're, like, chasing some perp?
Yeah.
He was talking about us, you know, being like a Manny Cast type. That would be something if instead of, you know, us doing something like in sports media, just do a ride along with you.
Yeah. It just has to be cleared, obviously. But Marvin Martin played with me at UL. He was on that show when it was like a different version of Cops, but he was working for Lafayette PD at the time, and they were riding with him. And they filmed him, and he made somebody get out of the car. He put someone over. It was for something minor. And he said, if you get out and dance and do like a little dance, then I'll give you a warning. And so they got out and danced, and they filmed it. It was pretty funny. You can look it up. And they got out and danced.
Don't give me any ideas. I'll get you in a lot of trouble.
Nah, man. Nah, we're going to have some fun.
A minor violation. Oh, he's got three blocks of heroin. You know what, man? Just do a little.
Oh, no, we ain't doing
do
that.
No.
We ain't doing that.
Look at now. See, now he's already getting nervous. Like,
nah,
you know what?
Man, we ain't doing
I got to have some good sense and not do this ride along thing with Scott. It'd be like a little reality. Should we just talk around? And just, you know, we drive around, we disagree on sports, and then we just arrest people.
Nah, man. No, but in a more serious sense, like with the accidents, like when you're the first person on scene for a lot of that stuff, and you see, like, the car flipped on top of somebody or, like, someone in the vehicle that's in pain. And it's just a lot of, you know, anxiety and a lot of, riding up to it.
I'm sure. You know, I can't even imagine, man.
So when you said that about the accidents, I was like,
stressing,
oh, snap. Like,
be safe out there, everybody. It's James and I like to joke around, but this is no joke. Be safe out there for sure. Let's go back to the phone lines. Good morning. Welcome in.
Hey, Scott. Hey, James. How y'all doing?
How you doing, man?
Jeff. It's your buddy Jeff, Scott.
Yes.
I'm calling in.
I know who this is, Jeffrey. This is, I'll tell you, James, this guy has known me since pretty much I was born.
Okay.
Longest friend. We were friends back in Opelousas, you know, as babies. So he probably knows me about as well as anybody.
That's very true. I'm on the Bonnie Carey Spillway, Scott. I got a hearing in Gretna at 9, and I got to catch these last couple of shows. It's an end of an era, man. I'm got mixed feelings about it for sure, but it was a trend that I had every day. I get up early in the morning, listen to your show, and head into work. I'm happy for your next chapter, but certainly kind of upset about not being able to do that anymore. Listen to you on my way in.
Thank you, brother. He used to listen on his drive home,
right?
And then I moved to the mornings, and he listened in the morning. I remember, like, early on, I think you and your dad called in once, like 16, 17 years ago, and started messing with me. So. Good memories.
Good stuff. I guess my question is about the Super Bowl. Do you think it's going to boil down to which quarterback is healthier? I mean, Hurts, we know that he's had his health issues, and Mahomes has as well. I would assume if, worst-case scenario, one of the quarterbacks gets hurt during the game, the other team's going to win. You know, I mean, is that going to be a big factor, whether or not which quarterback is healthier?
Yeah. I mean, look at what Philly did to the Niners. Once they took Brock Purdy out, not maliciously, but within the confines of the game, it was over.
Yeah, it was over.
He had Brandon Ayuk was wide open on that play too, by the way.
Yeah.
You know, if Haseem Reddick gets there late, if he falls, if he doesn't get to him, that's a touchdown, and who knows what happens. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe Purdy's confidence, but, you know, once he was out, nothing against Josh Johnson. I mean, he's, you know, played all over the world, but he wasn't ready, and then he got hurt, and it was pretty much over. You know, Chad Henne and Gardner Minshew, it's not like they have started games before, so it's not like they're a third or fourth string quarterback like you had in San Francisco. It'd be a little different, but it doesn't matter. I mean, if Hurts or Mahomes, you know, are not able to be a semblance of themselves or end up actually having to leave the game, I mean, forget about it.
Right.
Game over.
What do you think Payton's going to be able to do in Denver? Is he going to be able to turn that around, or what y'all think about that?
What do you think, James?
My heart is telling me I don't want him to because he quit on us.
My heart's telling me no.
You know, but in the reality of it is, man, I think Payton is going to change the culture
because
but you know, because they they have a bad culture right now, man. I don't know what they got going on. Players fussing at players. One player has a, you know, parking spaces and offices and stuff like that, and he's going to nip all that in the bud. I think he's going to change the culture. Now, that division is a tough division, so I'm not saying he's going to come out and automatically start winning, but I think he's going to have some success.
If he gets Russ back to being, you know, the Russell Wilson that was successful in Seattle, they've got a good defense. They've got good weapons. Yep. Yeah, they're in a really tough division, to James's point, but you know, fix the culture and fix the quarterback, and now you're contending. Mm-hmm. If you can't fix both of those things or either, then they're going to be in last place again.
Yep.
I just remember early on when Drew Brees of the Saints would play like Russell Wilson in Seattle, they would compare the two, you know, like Wilson kind of looks like a young Drew Brees. I mean, do you think Peyton may see that as well, or do you think
I doubt it. I think the only reason that happened is because they're both short. Yeah. And talking to Brandon Stokely yesterday, you know, Brandon works in Denver in sports radio, and he was saying, you know, with Wilson, it wasn't just sort of a locker room issue or not connecting with his teammates. He was trying to be pocket, step back, throw it, and get rid of the running aspect of his game and some of the things he did in Seattle to keep plays alive. And he said he was determined to try to be a different style of quarterback and not utilize all of, you know, the tools in the toolbox. And he felt like, you know, he was stubborn. He wanted to do it a certain way, and it failed miserably. He said, if, you know, and that's not Drew Brees, you know. Yeah. Like, Wilson at his peak was good, but you never looked at him and you're like, oh, that's the most accurate passer in NFL history.
Right.
You know, he was just able to keep plays alive and you know, he had a pretty deep ball, and he had good chemistry with his receivers and stuff. But I think Peyton's going to try to play to Russell Wilson's strengths. I don't think he's going to look at him the same way he looked at Drew Brees.
I got you. Makes sense. Well, look, very good, gentlemen. Scott, going to miss you on the air, but I mean, you know, we'll still miss you, man. But look, we'll see y'all soon. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jeff. Appreciate the call. Peyton in Denver. He's trying to nip in the bud all that stuff. You saw the clip about, you know, Russell Wilson's got his team here, and now he's like, oh, I don't know anything about that.
Right.
Remember, Scott. You remember Wayne Gandy?
Yes, I do. 72.
So he was still on the team when Peyton got there, and I didn't know that.
He was?
Well, but he didn't play. Like, they ended up, I don't remember if they cut him or traded him before they.
Didn't he go to the Falcons, huh?
Yes. Yes, I believe so. Or maybe he was at the Falcons before. But he had a big Lazy Boy recliner. And, you know, they had all kinds of stuff in the locker room. And Sean got in there, and he's like, we're not going to have any Lazy Boys. He's like, get rid of that recliner, get rid of this. And then I think maybe Gandy was not as receptive to that.
Right.
And he was gone.
And Joe Horn, too.
Well, Joe lasted a year.
I thought he stayed to '06 was the first year.
1 year
he left after.
But Dante Stallworth was gone.
Yeah,
number of guys. That '06 team, man, that was
fun.
Went to the
NFC Championship game.
It was so surreal.
I thought we was going all the way. Man.
Everyone, it was so surreal. I mean, at that point, prior to the season, won one playoff game, and then in '05, you're like, are they going to take the team away? Like all that stuff.
Yeah.
That '06 season, the most. That in 2000 are two of the most fun seasons ever.
You think 06 and 2000?
Obviously the Super Bowl season because you won it all.
Right.
But I always say this in sports, man.
Because it was unexpected?
Yeah. As a fan, if you're a tried and true fan of a team, like not just on the wagon or new,
right?
There's nothing better than the unexpected. Like 2017 was a blast for the Saints. Mm-hmm. Wasn't expecting that.
Right. Right.
Those seasons are the most fun because when you have a lot of expectations, man, it's with great expectations comes great disappointment. Because then, like in 2018, every game felt like, well, you have to win. It was agonizing. You got to get the one seed because if you don't, you know. And then you got the one seed, and then the nefarious non-call happened, and all of it. And it was like you should have been able to enjoy as a fan a 13-3 season, but there was a lot more anxiety. Whereas when you got that house money, it's like, boy, this is fun. How far can we take this? You know, Pelicans had a stretch last year. They were 1-12. They were 3-16. Yeah. They were 3-13 in the month of January. Felt a lot different because they had been in first place and the expectations had been lifted and all this stuff. It just felt a lot different than the beginning of last year, beginning of last season. And then when they finally went on a run, it was like, dude, how fun is this? How fun is this right now? Because and when that stuff happens, on top of just enjoying the unexpected ride, as a fan, you can get swept up in the idea of, God, the future is so bright.
Right.
Now, this is fun, but what about next season? What about that? Like, those, outside of a championship season, if you're a fan, I'm telling you, man, the most fun seasons are the ones where you're not expecting it. And it just kind of comes out of nowhere. Although for you, I guess you're all, I mean, you the way you talk about it, you're like always expecting your team to win it all every year. Mm-hmm. So are you able to enjoy, are those seasons even surprises for you?
That's a good question, man. That's a very good question. Nah, man, I just, in all seriousness, that 06 season was a very emotional roller coaster ride, man, because it's like, historically, the Saints, it was just so bad. And, like, you know, growing up, I was a diehard Saints fan. And, you know, back in New Orleans, we got talked about for that because the majority of people was 49ers fans or Cowboys fans. So, for me, like, that 06 season, us going to the NFC Championship game was so, like, thrilling to me. And I remember the 09 NFC Championship game, my heart rate had to be, like, dude, 120 the entire game.
It was, yeah. I mean, same.
Like, my heart was literally like the entire game was like this. I could not sit still, okay? And so, like, the Super Bowl, surprisingly, I was a little bit more calm. But it was like getting up to it. I
that
was
NFC
just like,
title game was, the anxiety was just
through the roof,
sky high the whole time. There was so much. And, like, Breeze didn't play good that game.
He didn't.
Nervous energy is such a real thing, man. And there was a lot of nervous energy in that building from a lot of people. Now, Pierre Thomas was incredible. You had a number of players in that game. They were like, no nerves. Right. Like, this is ours.
Yeah.
I think the Saints defense, you know, creating those turnovers, they never, despite giving up tons of yards, they never really felt defeated.
Yeah.
That was a surreal experience.
Were you at that game,
man,
too?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
It was out of body, which funny. I've told this story before. Real quick, let me hit a 10-second legal ID.
103.3 The GOAT.
Yeah, that's the one.
K277DQ Lafayette, 1420 KPEL Lafayette.
I don't, typically, you don't even get phone calls like when you're at a game because it's hard for a call to get through. Had I been watching that game at home, I don't think I would even been looking at my phone. I have no idea why I did it, James. No idea. It is late in the fourth quarter. You know what? Everyone is on their feet. Everyone is like nerves, you know, the changes in emotion for fandom. You go from like euphoria to just anguish in like moments. It's just back and forth. It's just roller coaster. It's part of why, you know, I think for fandom, people that only bet on sports, they can't grasp it. Wait, people just, they go through those emotions, but it didn't even have to do with their money. I'm like, yeah, that's like true fandom. I have no idea why, but like my phone started ringing and I answered it. I don't even know why. It was like refs reviewing something and it was someone that had worked here at the time, not at the station. And like they didn't know. Like they didn't grasp
how serious
the fan part of it. They were on another station and they were seeing if I could do like a hit after the game.
Mm-hmm.
And they're like, hey, Scott, it's, I'm not going to say their name. And I just go, yeah, not a good time. I was like, not a good time. I'm like, okay, well, I'll try. I was like, okay, cool, you can do that, bye. And then, like, apparently they did try to call me after the game, but they couldn't get through because things were just, everyone was using phones. Yeah. It was just crazy. I totally forgot about it. The next day I like, saw them and it, like, hit me. And I'm like, and they're like, oh, yeah, Scott,
what
about that phone call? I was like, no. I usually would apologize. I am not going to apologize.
No, right.
I was like, you are going to. And they were like, excuse me? I'm like, you don't understand. You can't. You could text me or something. You can't call in that moment.
So,
but then I was like, why did I answer the phone? It was so stupid.
Right. Were you at the game before against the Cardinals?
Oh, yeah. Okay. Dude, I don't think I missed a game that season.
Okay.
Maybe that's one. Cool, maybe man. I wouldn't have the Giants game. That was my wife and I's first year of marriage, and I just kept telling her because she'd come to the games. I'm like, It ain't like this. Yeah. Like, it's not. This is not how. And she had been to a few games, like, you know, when we were dating or engaged, maybe one or two. But like that 09 season, like everybody was along for the ride. And I just kept saying, it's not. This isn't normal. It's not normally like this.
That's cool, man.
It was a great
actually.
Were you at that game?
No, the game against the Cardinals. I was actually on my recruiting visit here.
Really?
Yes.
That was the game Reggie went off.
Yep. And that's how I was watching the game in the hotel room in Lafayette.
Man, what if the Saints had like lost that game and blown it? You might have been like, oh, I can't go to UL.
Probably.
Be too much. But there was so much positive energy from your experience.
That's probably what happened, dude.
I can imagine is like if you're on a recruiting visit and you're not some 5-star that's getting offered, financial things. I would imagine just. How you feel on the trip is everything. Not just the comfort level of a city, but literally like your one bad experience.
Right.
Shoot, I imagine if you're recruited by like 5 or 6 schools and you just have a bad like restaurant experience, like, oh, that meal.
Right.
Oof, God.
Right. Yeah.
Everything has to align perfectly. It's a good thing the Saints went off that day.
Yeah,
you might not have been at UL.
Nah, but then again, I got to think like one of my best friends who was like a year older than me, he was already here. Already enrolled and all that other stuff, and I was already in contact with Darryl Sergeant, you know, Coach Rebo at the time that was here. He was so consistent with talking with me. It was just like, I think I'm gonna go here. So that was my whole experience. But yeah, man, that's cool that you went to those playoffs games like that. I wish I could have went to one.
I'll never forget it, man. And being at the Super Bowl, those are, you know, with my mom, it's stuff I'm forever grateful for. Yeah. Like, I'll never forget it. There's nothing like the first time. I mean, hopefully, you know, the Saints win another one at some point. But
when we get Derek Carr, we're going to be back.
There's nothing. Oh, so you're on the Carr train now.
I've been on the Carr train. Ben.
No, first of all, no.
Ben.
No. You have not been a passenger in the Derek Carr
car. Yes, I have been.
See, this is going to be one of those things where I end up defending myself, but it makes me seem like I think Derek Carr is going to be a future Hall of Famer, and then James is going to reverse it and make it seem like I'm not. You remember the show before the season when we were going and you were all in on Jameis Winston, and I was telling you, James, like, calm down. You didn't want to hear my advice.
Okay.
You swore it was going to be a Super Bowl and he was going to be the MVP, and I said, look, I got nothing against Jameis. I like the guy, but I'm not going to freak out over it. And you said, oh, well, who'd you take over him? And I was like, name some players. You started naming other quarterbacks in the NFL. And you were giving me grief for the number of players I said that I would take over Jameis Winston.
Okay.
One of them was Derek Carr.
That's not true.
It is true.
That is not true.
You could not believe it. You were like, stop it. There's no way.
That is not true.
James.
That's not true, Scott. Grief over Kirk Cousins.
No.
I didn't give you grief over Derek Carr.
No, for the record, I said...
You said you would take Kirk Cousins.
That's not what I said. No.
So you wouldn't...
Here's what I said about Kirk Cousins. I said, I'm supposed to say yes because he is better. Statistically, we would take that. I said, but because it's Kirk Cousins...
Oh, you did say that.
I can't actually do it.
You did say that.
I said I should, but objectively, I should say absolutely... But I just can't look at him and be like, sure. With Derek Carr, you were like, Scott, come on.
That's not true.
You did not. You're going to sit here and act like before the season, when you asked that question, you were like, oh, yeah, I'd take Derek Carr.
All right, can I be honest? Can I be honest for a second?
I want you to always be honest. Can I
stop joking around and be honest for a second? All right, listen. If you haven't noticed, if someone is already on the team, I'm not choosing somebody else over them. I'm not. That's why the whole Aaron Rodgers thing, I'm not trying to hear it. He's not on the team. Okay? Everything that we were saying were hypotheticals, but now that it's about to be a reality, it's shifted now. This is the same guy that came on here and said Trevor Siemian was going to take us to the promised land.
Okay? Yes, but ladies and gentlemen, when he says this is the same guy, please know that he is talking about himself. Please know that.
This is the same guy that said that. I'm not getting on here and say anything negative. With that being said, we're going to be right back in that position once Derek Carr becomes our quarterback.
Well, he's not on the team, James.
But he's about to be.
So why are you saying this stuff? He's not on the team.
He's about to be.
I like how you just glazed over the past with some ridiculous excuses.
Like what?
That somehow makes it sound like you didn't say what you said.
What's an excuse?
You're saying you just said you've always been on the, I like how you said Carr train. His last name is Carr. You don't have to use the train metaphor. You can literally just use his name.
Nah, I got to use a train. But look, man, look. No, for real, like, all jokes aside, the first time.
Man,
I'm going to call my sister. I'm going to call my sister right now.
Go ahead.
I'm going to call my sister because the first time it was reported, now.
Sure. As soon as someone might be on the Saints, they become your favorite.
No. Yeah, that's true. That's very true. That's all right. I can't argue that. But the first time it was reported that.
Oh, gosh.
Years ago when the Raiders wanted to move on from Derek Carr, I was telling my family, I said, I think this will be a good fit. Now, that was with Sean Payton. Now he's gone. We all know that. Do I still like Derek Carr as a quarterback? Yeah, I do. But we got to see, you know, what's going on with that. Like, are they going to release him? Are we going to give him a third-round pick? I don't think we should give him a third-round pick if they're going to release him. But, I mean, what you think going to happen with that, Scott? You think we're going to have to give him, like, trade compensation? Or you think they're just going
to... That's what his agent wants, because his agent wants him to keep his current contract.
Yeah, but we can't do that.
And the Raiders want anything for him because why not? You're not going to have him anyway. And I went from – I have maintained that they need to let the clock run out and then just sign him.
Okay.
And if he goes somewhere else, do something else. Don't break the bank for him.
Yeah.
But with these recent reports, I'm not saying I would do this. I believe that they are going to trade for Derek Carr.
So what's the recent report? You talking about what came out yesterday?
Yeah, just the you could say, oh, they're only whining and dining him because once he is released, they want to have a leg up and all that other stuff. But I think that it'll be like a
third round or something like that.
It might be a little later than that.
So what do you think about Carr?
But to me, it's not so much draft compensation. I mean, which by the way, they could have had a third-round compensatory pick if they hadn't assigned Andy Dalton when they signed him last year. They could have waited until a certain window ended, and then they could have signed him, and they would have still had a third-round compensatory pick. But no, they had to run out and sign Dalton like 1,000 teams were trying to get him. Anyway, it's neither here nor there. But point is, this is a new regime. You know, I see people saying every time the Saints bring someone into the facility, they usually sign them.
Mm-hmm.
That's the old Saints.
That's the old Saints, right.
This is Dennis Allen's Saints.
Right.
Okay? We don't know. There's no guarantees here. And do I think Carr is better than Jameis Winston? Yes. Do I think he's better than Andy Dalton? I do. I don't think that Derek Carr is a top 10 quarterback that's going to suddenly... You know, you might be able to compete in the NFC South because it's putrid.
Name 10 quarterbacks in the league right now is better than Derek Carr.
Off the top of my head?
Off the top of your head, name 10.
Shoot, Patrick Mahomes.
Okay, that's given.
Justin Herbert.
Okay.
Jalen Hurts. Tua Tagovailoa. All of these.
You think Tua is better than Derek Carr?
When healthy.
Are you serious?
When healthy, sure.
Come on, man. Stop it, Scott.
This is ridiculous.
All right. You know what? This is your list.
You were ripping on him.
This is your list. No, I was not. All right, so
yes,
Tua.
Yes, you did.
Jalen Hurts.
They're all better than Carr.
I'm going off your list. Justin Herbert, Patrick Mahomes. Who else?
Your friend Aaron Rodgers.
Okay, that's five. This is getting kind of tight, isn't it?
No, I'm just thinking of. Can I pull
up
the
Joe Burrow?
Oh, yeah, of course, Joe
Josh
Burrow.
Allen.
Josh Allen.
That's seven.
You know, Lamar Jackson.
That's eight.
Let me pull up a list of teams. I'm not looking up players, teams, because you're making me do this off the top of my head.
That's eight.
Yeah. Who else? This is going to be easy. Give me a second.
It's not going to be easy because you're eight.
I'm missing out. I'm missing out on people.
Kyler Murray. You think Kyler Murray better than Derek Carr?
Absolutely not.
Okay.
Absolutely not.
Okay. So he's like an eight?
Yeah, I think that...
What about Matthew Stafford?
Stafford is better, sure.
That's nine?
Stafford is better. I can't say Kirk Cousins. That would just be wrong.
What about Jared Goff?
They're kind of adjacent. They're kind of adjacent. I think you could throw like a big mix of them in there, and they're somewhat similar.
So we had nine. So I need one more so I could prove my point.
I mean, you think Derek Carr is better than Dak Prescott? I don't.
Yes, I do. Are you serious right now?
Yeah. I don't think he's better than Dak Prescott.
You don't think he's better than
Dak?
No. So who has the most fourth quarter and overtime comebacks
right now?
Out of every quarterback in the league?
I would guess probably Aaron Rodgers or someone that's played for a really long time.
Look it up.
Look what up?
Look up.
What do you want me to Google?
Look up who has the most fourth quarter and overtime comebacks out of active quarterbacks in the league. But first of all, Dak Prescott is not better than Derek Carr. Stop it.
I don't think that either of them are great. That's what this thing usually turns into. You make me sound like I'm some kind of stan
about
something.
We still stuck
at
9. I'm not about to sit up here and let you say
The most would be Matt Ryan.
Are you serious?
Yeah. Followed by Matthew Stafford.
So, first of all, Dak Prescott.
Followed by Derek Carr, who has one more than Russell Wilson, who has three more than Andy Dalton.
So, I'm not about to accept
that. Listen, here's another guy that's better. I don't like this guy. But Deshaun Watson is a better quarterback.
Okay. I give you that one.
Yeah.
I give you that one over the Dak Prescott one, though.
You know,
I cannot accept
if you
that
told
Dak
me
Prescott
right now,
one.
If you told me right now, would you take Trevor Lawrence or Derek Carr? I'd take Trevor Lawrence.
Okay,
for sure.
I give you that one, too.
You know?
I give you that one, too.
Like, I've given you more than 10.
That's
I mean, 11. Come on.
I give you that
no,
one.
No, you're not giving me one. It doesn't matter. You don't have to give him. It's my list.
But see, the list got tight, though.
Would you take Justin Fields or would you take Derek Carr?
Ooh, that's tough.
You don't
Justin Fields is so young.
Yeah. You see what I'm saying?
What's my coaching staff?
Like the Saints coaching staff. Silly, you know what the staff is. You got to work with Pete Carmichael. The point is, Carr is fine. He's not a top 10 quarterback. He's not going to come in and make the Saints a contender.
Yes, he is.
He's going to make the Saints contend possibly in the NFC South, but that's because it's the worst division ever, and no one has a quarterback right now in that division.
Yeah,
nobody.
They do.
Nobody.
Yeah, we do.
No, they don't.
Yeah, we do.
No, they don't.
Yeah, we do.
They're gonna move on from Jameis. Andy Dalton's a free agent. Who knows who the Bucs gonna play?
What about Geno Smith?
Geno Smith, I would not say he is better than Derek
Carr. Okay, I appreciate that.
Because, look, Geno had a great year.
All right.
Derek Carr has had more solid years than Geno Smith. Derek Carr's problem is he's extremely inconsistent. One week, you're like, good Lord, how's this guy not an MVP candidate? And the next week, you watch him play the Saints, who weren't good this year, and he didn't cross the 50-yard line.
Hey, but you know what? You know who you forgot that might not be the best? You might just say, what about Kenny Pickett? What you think about him?
I'm not big on
you. You're not sold on him?
No.
I thought he played well down the stretch, though.
No. He played okay. I think he gets the most out of his talent. Look, Carr's arm is... Carr has plenty of tools. Carr was an MVP candidate in 2014 before he got hurt. A legit MVP candidate. That was also, what, or 2015 rather. That was also, what, 8 years ago. So it's been a while. I would take him over Jimmy Garoppolo. I would take him over Andy Dalton. I'd take him over some of these other names that have been floated out there.
What about Ryan Tannehill?
But, yeah, I would take him over Tannehill. I think Tannehill's but not by a ton.
About Sam Darnold.
Like, once you get outside of the elite quarterbacks and you start getting, once you get between 10 and 20, it's kind of a wash.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And he's in that wash group.
Okay.
He's not in the, oh God, you know, you're gonna start Marcus Mariota and then at some point you're gonna move to, you know, Desmond Ridder. Like, you're not in that situation.
You know he made it to the playoffs last year, right?
Yes, I'm
that, right?
Fully aware of
with
Derek
everything
Carr's,
that went on with the. With
you're
the
sitting
Raiders.
Here acting like I don't like the guy when I was the one that said a year ago I would gladly take Derek Carr over Jameis Winston, and you started calling me all these ridiculous.
I did not say
yes,
that.
You did. You started calling me names.
Not,
you started saying
real.
I can't believe you
that's
said that,
real.
Scott. You know it is.
That's not real.
You know it is.
But I told
why
you why.
Why do you have to deny the past?
I told you why it's real.
Yeah, because whenever you say something that's not right, you like to lean. You basically you just blame it on your fandom. You're like, yeah, but that wasn't my fault.
Is.
That was my fandom.
That's
fault.
Exactly what it is.
It wasn't me talking.
Because listen,
it wasn't me talking.
Because the reality of it is, I'm gonna tell you the reality of it. The fandom in me is not going to accept anything over what we currently have. But the reality of it is, when I have conversations with other people, I actually like Derek Carr as a quarterback, and I thought we should have made this trade years ago. Honestly, that's just me.
That's why.
That's just me.
You're come on.
I'm not making that up. I'm being serious.
You said that you...
But I'm not going to sit up here and say James
Here's a funny stat for you. Kirk Cousins has more fourth quarter comebacks than Aaron Rodgers. Aaron Rodgers has been playing since 2005. Cousins has been in the league 7 years longer. Cousins has more fourth quarter comebacks than Aaron Rodgers.
What do you think they're going to do this year?
Ryan Tannehill has four more fourth quarter comebacks.
Do you think they should move on from Ryan Tannehill? The Titans.
I don't think it matters. I don't think it matters. I think they missed him this year, but he's good for what he's good for their system.
Okay.
I think they would regret it a little bit, and that's not to say that Ryan Tannehill is a top 10 quarterback. He's in that wash group, right? But shoot, man, 25 fourth quarter comebacks. Who knew? That's pretty impressive. Ryan Tannehill.
Ryan Tannehill?
25.
That's because they...
Tied for fifth among current quarterbacks because Brady's retired. You know who he's tied for fifth with?
That's because who?
Yes.
Drew Brees?
Brees isn't in the league, silly. These are active quarterbacks.
Oh, active quarterbacks?
Yeah, he's not fifth. He's not fifth Dak all
Prescott?
Time.
No, not Dak Prescott. It's going to have to be somebody.
Andy Dalton.
Are you serious?
Yeah, you're sitting here talking about Derek
Carr. Rifle. Hey, but look, that's because the reason why he's like that is because they run the ball in a 2-minute drill and nobody expects it. And they move down the field. And
I mean,
throw like a late touchdown.
No.
That counts. That's why they do it.
Fourth quarter comebacks. I mean, that's. You could try to.
So you. No, man, I can't let you get past what you just said. You would take Dak Prescott over Derek Carr.
On the Saints, maybe not. But I think he's probably a little better. I think he's probably a little bit of a better quarterback.
Okay.
I didn't say I would take him over. I think Derek Carr would be a better fit for the Saints. I mean, again, Prescott and Carr, they're in that wash group. That's all I'm saying.
Okay.
They're both in the – I'm not saying that, like, it's some big gap, but you get outside of, like, the top eight, and there's a pretty big gap there.
Right.
And then you get out – then you go from, like, 20 to 32, and then there's another gap.
Right. Yeah.
You know, if you have someone in the wash group, well, you can compete in a crummy division like the NFC South.
But, man, I thought we was going to get that third pick, though, man. Dang.
No, you get your hopes up because you're unrealistic.
How's that unrealistic?
Just blame the fan.
I thought the Cardinals was going to make that move,
man. Let's take a phone call. Good morning. Welcome into the Great Scott Show. Help me here. You're on the air with me and James.
All right, Scott. I'll help you a little bit, and I'll hurt you a little, too. I wasn't around. I didn't hear what kind of names James Butler called you when you said you take Carr over Winston, but he had every right to call you every name in the book over that because Winston's way over Derek Carr. But,
I appreciate that.
Yeah.
You think James is on your side. The second they trade for Carr, James is going to start calling you names.
You're exactly right.
You're trying.
Okay, exactly right.
Your problem is you're approaching James as if he's like, you know, got some semblance of like objectivity.
But I don't.
Okay. He doesn't. Let's just be real here.
Okay. So Carr is not the answer. Carr is trash. And I got a case closed for Carr. Let's start with the idea that Andy Dalton is a houseplant at quarterback. Or a houseplant is better than Andy Dalton at quarterback. The Saints, just with Andy Dalton houseplanting at quarterback, beat Derek Carr 24-0 this year. And Derek Carr had Devontae Adams, the best wide receiver in the NFL.
I mean, the Saints did the yeah, Saints beat the Saints beat the snot
guy?
Out of the Packers 2 years ago, and Aaron Rodgers had Devontae Adams. I don't think that means that Aaron Rodgers isn't
that's
good.
Different, man, that's different.
I mean, that's a bit of a small sample size. Come on, the guy's played in 142 games. You're picking one game. I don't think that serves as a good argument.
But what has he ever done? He's not the answer.
What has Jameis Winston ever done?
He was almost.
Derek Carr's done more than Jameis Winston.
Jameis Winston sat in tutelage of Drew Brees and Sean Payton and was ready to rock and roll, and he started it already.
You can stay on the Jameis Island. It's gone.
Nah,
the ship
man,
is gone.
I got to disagree with you,
the ship
man.
Is gone.
I got to disagree with you. I think Derek Carr is, I'm not going to say a great quarterback. I think he's a good quarterback. I'm not going to say he's garbage because of that game against the Saints. He went to the playoffs last year. well, not last year, the year before last, with everything that was going on with the Raiders organization, with Gruden being fired,
so
with that guy
killing,
with that guy getting the car accident.
Yeah.
You know, all that stuff that was going on with the Raiders, the guy still brought him to the playoffs, still almost beat the Bengals that went to the Super Bowl. I don't think he's trash, man. I just think, you know,
he's
got to be in a better situation.
Here's I'll tell everybody. This is what's going to happen.
I don't think he's the answer.
Yeah, but I don't think they have an answer. They don't. They're interested in trying to compete in a crummy division. They're not.
Well, they're clueless. This the idea that they went with Dalton this year over Winston. Do you know what I found out after the Bengals when they were just cruising through the playoffs this year, and they were talking about, as you know, the first consecutive years with a playoff win and so and so. And I had to go look up how close Andy Dalton came to winning two playoff games in a row in his career. Do you know what Andy Dalton's career postseason record is?
What is it?
0-4 or something?
Yeah, 0-4, yeah, something like that.
Yeah, 0-4. It was his first four seasons in the league. He went 0-4. The average score against him was 27-11. Yeah. He never even in the second half he scored a total of 6 points in the four games, and I think they're both in the same game. He was shut out in the second half in three of the games.
Yeah, that was
and
Cincinnati
this is the guy
playoffs.
That they thought could lead us. What's that?
I mean, you're saying these things like, but you never put anything up for Jameis Winston other than he learned under Drew Brees for a season. Like, I don't think
I think that's everything.
I think you're overvaluing. I mean, how many good quarterbacks have come out of New Orleans since under Drew Brees that learned under the tutelage of Drew Brees?
It's not everybody. It's that
it's
when you
no
couple
one.
It with the evidence we saw with
it's,
our eyes.
It's no
that he had
one.
Already made the transition.
You and James act like in his 5-2 start that he was like playing like Johnny Unitas in his prime. Come on, man.
Nah, but he.
I don't even like this because then it makes it sound like I hate Jameis. I'm just trying to calm y'all down. Y'all are too fanatical.
Well, okay. Here's the thing. He had already thrown for like 5,000 yards or whatever, and he had a 30 touchdown season. Now it came with 30 interceptions. So what could you say possibly was the only problem with Winston? It was that he. His ball control. He was too easy with the interceptions. So he was like a Brett Favre.
You lean on like wins and losses when it's an argument against someone else, but you lean on just the good stats for Jameis. I mean, you're picking and choosing
I'm not
here.
And
you
anywhere?
You're bringing up stats. And you brought up wins and losses for Andy Dalton and Derek Carr, but with Jameis, it's stats. I mean, Jameis didn't win a bunch in Tampa Bay. He had one good season.
I don't need the Tampa Bay Andy Winston. I'm talking about
a very small sample size. I mean, I just
we had seven games.
Very small. Yes, it's very small sample size.
Seven games and went 5-2.
Small sample size, but that was plenty big enough to see that whatever Sean Payton was instilling in Winston was sticking, and he was learning how to not throw the interception. And I think you saw that last year.
I mean, you guys are welcome to hang on to that forever. And it was good. It was a fun start in 2021. They surpassed expectations, but he's gone and he's not coming back.
If you're saying that, then I believe you. And I believe you simply because they didn't even try to use him when they had him this year, which was insane.
He started the first game and then he got hurt.
Carr's got what he needs. I don't know. I'm hoping they draft somebody.
They still might. That's still a possibility. I just want Derek Carr.
All right, man. I appreciate the call. We got three other lines lit up. We're going to keep it rolling here. Good morning. Welcome into the show. Hello.
So you think that if the Saints acquire someone like Carr, it's good, like a Matt Schaub?
I hope not.
Golly.
It kind of is Matt Stafford. No, I won't say that.
Come on, man.
Matt Stafford?
Matt Stafford.
I see what you're saying. I think Stafford's peak in Detroit was still better than Carr's peak in Oakland. In Vegas.
So if Matt Stafford was still in Detroit, you would say he was better than Derek Carr.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know, man. Yeah. I think like
absolutely.
Well Dan Campbell's
Detroit.
They got Detroit
to the playoffs. Lions. I mean, he put up huge numbers. No, I think if you're talking about both of their Carr's younger now than Stafford, but if you're talking about who's got the higher ceiling for a single season, even though he was hurt last year, it's still Matt Stafford.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you go acquire Carr, your hope is that you have him for more than 1 year. You hope that you know this is the final stop of his career and he's there for a while. But
I told my mom, I said, I'm going to get two Derek Carr jerseys as soon as he signs.
Dude,
I'm going to get a black one.
The thing about Aaron Rodgers, you know, his situation is, you know, I need some receivers. I think New Orleans would be a nice team for him, a nice organization because of the receivers.
Look, man, I don't care how much ayahuasca he does. If you get Aaron Rodgers for a year, do it. Do it. It could backfire, but, boy, the ceiling's higher, isn't it?
Yeah. But
in that division?
Yeah. Yeah, for sure.
Hey, man, how did the Nets not get Ayton?
I
don't know how.
The Lakers
what is going
and
on?
Suns got some good. They did well in their trades. They did well in their trades. Yeah, I don't know how you don't. I don't know how you don't get DeAndre Ayton thrown in there if you're the Suns, but if you're the Nets rather.
The Nets. The Nets are. I'm glad Irvin and Durant's out of that organization. That's garbage. You know what I'm saying?
Phoenix, man, golly.
They're still going to lose, so I'm not even worried about that.
Yeah.
Lose at what point, though?
Wait, what did you say?
James said they're still going to lose, so he's not worried about it.
Who, the Nets?
No, he's talking about the Suns.
Oh, the Suns. That's what I'm talking about. I'm sorry. Yeah. Injuries, you know.
I do think it's concerning when you have a 34 and 37-year-old that do have health issues. I think that could put a wrench in all this, but... Look, whoever comes out of the West this year is going to be the team that is most healthy.
Yep,
that's it.
Yep,
like that's it.
I know everyone keeps saying Denver, man, Denver's not going to do anything when it comes to playoff time.
We'll see.
They'll fizzle out. Hey man, Anita Baker, you going?
Nah, man, I don't think I can. I think I work.
Well, he should work. He should be security for.
Nah, man, that's a whole different. I don't think we even do that. But I kept getting seeing it on Twitter, and I liked it a couple of times. I was like, man, but I think I got to work that day.
Yeah. All right. Well,
you going, Jay? You going to be at Anita Baker?
Who?
You.
Man, I got a kid. I just had a kid, man.
Yeah, that's right. You're not. That's true. I forgot. Yeah, you're not. You're not going to any of that. That's true.
Congrats.
It'll be a while.
Yeah.
Yep. It's all good. But yeah, man. Hey, so y'all last show together, huh?
Yep. Unfortunately.
Although someone suggested we decided we should do a ride along where we film me tagging along with James in his day job, which I think would be interesting.
You think we should do that?
I see that. I would see that on Twitter. But James, I'm glad over the month y'all, you know, I saw how he treated you, man.
Like a friend.
He was a friend. And,
that's right.
And he didn't treat, you know, the way he used to make fun of you, how he used to tease you, especially with your Jameis Winston take.
I'm glad
that, you know, you got him straight. You straightened him out, man.
Yeah, because you would swear he's not a Saints fan, like, when
it's
I walk
true.
In here.
Stop that.
You know
that's
what I'm saying?
True.
So I had to, like, that's why I had to, like, really see what was going on, because he acts like he's not a fan sometimes.
It's not true.
Like, I don't know how you can say anything negative, you know? And then he got people at me on Twitter talking about, I thought you said James was going to be the MVP and all this other stuff.
I didn't do it. You said it, not me.
Like, man, give me a break, man.
I take up for you all the time.
Man, but just I appreciate
not to you.
Man. Thanks. Scott, right, we should really
well,
do
thank
like.
Thank y'all. Y'all have a good one.
We should really do like the Manning cast, bro. We should really do that.
If there's any producers out there that want to put that together,
man.
We'll do something like that. We'll just call it, you know.
So much that goes into that.
Butts
I can't. I'm not doing Saints games with you, man, because you're gonna make fun of me.
No, that's not true.
You're gonna make fun of me.
So maybe.
I can't watch a Saints game with you because I have a ritual
here,
that I have
here's,
to do.
Look, first of all, I don't want to watch Saints games with you, for the record. So
why?
And secondly, you're assuming.
What are you trying to say?
You're assuming that I watch games with the same. The same mindset that I objectively break down the teams with on this show. And I'm here to tell you, You can ask anyone in my family or my kids or my wife. I do not. I watch those games like a fan.
Okay.
Shoot, we were at the UL game, and huge game tonight, by the way. Sole possession of first place, Louisiana at Southern Miss, 20-4, 10 straight wins. We'll be on the air 6:30 pregame over on our sibling station, News Talk 96.5 KPEL, the women's game you can hear right here. We were at the game Saturday night. Great environment at the mm-hmm. Cajun Dome. Solid win. Jordan Brown was on. I mean, at 26-20. I was watching the Pels Lakers on my phone when I was in there.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that game started at 5, and so it's just a basic, you know, someone's just dribbling up the floor after made free throw in the Cajun Dome, and all of a sudden I'm just like, yes! And all these people look over, and they're like, what the heck? My wife's like, what are you doing? I'm like, the streak's over. Like Trey hit those back-to-back threes. I'm like, gotta get this, you know. Yeah. I was
the same way, though.
I was screaming. I wasn't like, man, you know, it's just one win. Like, they've lost 10 in a row. Let's look at the bigger picture. No.
Yeah.
No, not when I'm in the moment, bro.
Yeah.
No. Let's take one more, and then we got to take a break. We're overdue for it. Good morning. Welcome into the show. Hello. And goodbye.
Shout out to Brandon Ingram, though. Shout out to Brandon Ingram, man.
He's feeling good. Man. You can tell.
What a difference he makes, huh?
Yeah. How about that? When you have your best players.
How about that? Now we just need. Come on, Zion, man. Like, we just need. Like, come on, man. But I guess that's why.
It's not going to be until after the All-Star break.
And that's fine. But I guess that's why you didn't get a sense of panic from the organization, because they kind of like, we're going
to
be fine.
They're going to make a trade today for the deadline at 2? No. Not a small trade?
Would you trade Devontae Graham?
Depends on what you get.
No, I'm saying, but like, they was trying to package Devontae Graham.
Sure. Every Pelicans fan package, most of them are like Graham, Hayes, and Garrett Temple and a Dyson. Future pick for this really good player. I'm like,
it's not going to work.
But you have to give up more than that.
Would you give up Dyson?
Dude, I love Dyson. It all depends on what it's for. I don't want to. You got that guy on a rookie deal. He's an elite defender. I love Dyson Daniels.
So, because they always say that guy in Toronto, I don't know, I forgot his
name. No, the OG, and you know, that's way, the amount that you can get, like Gary Trent and like a decent player for some guys that are at the end of your bench, sure. But I don't know that OG marginally, like, I don't know that the margin of how much better he makes your team is.
Yeah.
Lose, if you're to give up like Dyson or Inagi in a deal like that, like,
no.
You know
no,
what I'm saying? Yeah, like, no. I don't. I'm all for any deals that are like Graham, Hayes, Temple for this player that would be in the rotation. I'm like, sure.
But here's the question, though. Do you think we need to make a trade?
I think what is their mindset? Is their mindset, listen, we want to get far in the playoffs this year, and these other teams are making moves, so we have to, and we're not even going to be thinking about the future cap or next offseason, or are they still big picture focused? Like, yeah, we want to get far this year, but we don't want to jeopardize the next few seasons right now. We're going to try to do that, obviously, no matter what. We're going to try to do it with this core. And if we can get this core healthy, like, what is their mindset? And I think their mindset is probably more of the former than, like, I don't think they're going to say, we got to put all our chips on the table, or we got to put a lot of chips on the table, rather, right now. I don't think that's the case. And so I could see them making a trade, but it's not going to be like
anything drastic.
I don't think they're going to be giving up a future core piece that's on a great contract.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I don't. Because I don't see them acquiring like that level of player. And if they do, you know, then I'd be for it, but I don't think it's going to happen. I think if anything happens, it's a small move. Maybe you see Hayes gone, maybe. But I tell you what, I was at Dick's Sporting Goods yesterday to return something that my wife had gotten there. There's a lot of Devontae Graham gear.
Really?
Just because it wasn't selling.
Yeah.
Like there was some Ingram and Zion stuff. There's even, you know, some Alvarados, even a few Dyson Daniels things. There couple Herb things. There was a lot of, I'm like, boy, they They ordered too many of these.
He didn't play well down the stretch, man. He just
if he's not hit, if he's not hitting his three,
yeah.
What are you doing? You know.
And it seemed like that's the only thing he wants to do.
Well, it's what they're probably telling him to do, and I do think he's an underrated defender.
Yeah.
I do. But if his shot's off, you know, I think he's an underrated defender, and that everyone just sort of looks over him because of his height. He doesn't have the length, but I think he's a smart defender. Put it that way.
Shout out to Kyra Lewis, man.
Yeah, Kyra getting some of those minutes now, and I think, you know, I don't know, a lot of these suggested trades I see, I'm like, first of all, this probably wouldn't happen because it's a bit one-sided, and secondly, the ones that do seem a little more realistic, I'm like,
you have to give up something in the core piece.
Like,
yeah.
You've got great pieces when you consider the contracts that some of them are on.
Mm-hmm.
You got Dyson on a rookie deal. You got Trey on a rookie deal. You got Herb on a rookie deal. You got Najee on an Alvarado on these great deals because they came up undrafted through the G League. You got Dyson. Like, if you want to make a move, I think you wait until the offseason. You show everybody what you can do in the postseason, and then you're like, see what we're working with here?
Yeah.
Like, now let's make something. I mean, for the Pelicans, you know, the truth is they don't sign great free agents. I mean, they're really good acquisitions. The really good core pieces are all either drafted or they traded for them. And so I don't if you don't get anything, you know, really good in free agency this summer, then you just wait till the next trade deadline because you have the assets to do it. But I don't think they're going to do anything drastic. They make a move today, it's not going to be drastic. Let's take a timeout. I got to get your pick on the Super Bowl. We didn't even talk about the Super Bowl. It's in a couple days.
I don't care.
Okay, there. Well, more of that when we come back right after this on 103.3 The GOAT simulcast on 1420.
If it's not the GOAT, then they're full of sheep. 103.3 The GOAT, the greatest sports talk of all time.
Welcome back into the Great Scott Show. Final segment here with my friend J-Butt, James Butler, Jimmy Butt.
What's up, Scott, man?
You all right?
I appreciate you having me all these years, man.
It's been fun, man. I remember interviewing you
back
at the alumni house. Y'all are doing like UL football media, 2011 maybe.
Yeah.
I think you had braces.
Yep. I did, yeah.
And then interviewed you a lot. I did like a feature piece on you for one of the New Orleans Bowls on the pregame show. And then when you finished, at some point, we just like, hey, man, you want to come in? And, you know, we recorded some stuff. And then we just kind of kept rolling and had fun with it. And then at some point, you just started coming in.
Yeah. Nah, man, it's been cool, man.
I'll say this. The reception when you're on is, you know, as you could tell, we're actually being serious, everybody, has been great. Like, I get more people that, like, some people know you, some people don't. I'll see people, like, sometimes at church I saw someone, and it was like an old friend I hadn't seen in a while. He's like, man, who's that guy that goes on with you sometimes? James, he, like, used to play football. I'm like, yeah, James Butler. Like, yeah, him. They're like, man, that's funny when he's on with you. That is some good stuff. Like, they all, you know, the reception is good. And I think what you did was you, probably quicker than, I mean this, probably quicker than anybody I've ever known, especially for someone that wasn't like, that didn't come up in this business or anything, you immediately understood the psychology of this medium. And I'm not making a therapist joke, which I do all the time when you're
right,
on here.
Right.
But you immediately understood, like, this is a show, like, it doesn't matter what you say, it matters how you say it,
right?
And I'm not gonna go in there and take myself real serious and act like I know everything, because that's not
right
fun radio. And you, like, got it, like, immediately, like, unspoken.
Yeah.
And it was was so fun. Just come in here and start saying some things that people are like, man, Scott, you're always over there like serious. I'm like, my mic's off sometimes. Like, sometimes he has me laughing a lot. But I just don't want that to go out over the air because it's funnier if you just say these ridiculous things and it's just silence, like I'm just incredulous. Like,
man. It's been fun, man. I've gained some friends over it. Like, I never would have met Maddie or probably wouldn't even know Devin. You know what I'm saying? Not actually know him, but just like know of him, you know? It's been cool, man. I've enjoyed it. Of course, you know, this is not the end of our friendship. Of course, you know, I'm going to be, you know, around.
You'd be texting me during Saints games and like, you know.
All of that.
Just a panic.
All of that, you know. Me and you are actual friends. It's the first time and last time I ever admit that on the show. We're actually friends.
Finally.
And, man, it's just been cool, man. I'm very appreciative of this whole experience. I'll be honest. My mom even said, she's like, man, you're not going to be on the radio anymore because Scott is leaving. I was like, yep, it's over.
Personal question.
Okay.
The wonderful woman in your life.
Mm-hmm.
Come on, man. When is this going to happen?
Soon, man.
Come on.
Soon.
When are you going to bend the knee?
Soon, man. I just had to, you know, she just finished school, so I had to.
She's awesome.
You know.
She's awesome.
She got a master's. She's
She's
going
to
be a counselor.
When she came in here with you that time, boy, I set you up so good.
Yeah, you did.
Started asking James about his New Orleans Bowl rings. I'm like, what's the deal? Like, you never wear them? You're like, nah, man. I mean, I got to keep them. Got to keep them stashed away. I don't really like wearing them. I'm like, so that's why you're allergic to rings. I was like, how do you feel about that? And then, the tone of your face changed.
I was like, man, why are you doing this?
Started getting pale. And I was like, that was the only time that I was like, I think he's actually
like upset.
I thought for a moment. And she was sitting there and she's like, I like this, Scott. Right. This is good. Actually, James, why don't you answer that question? And you just go, you set me up, Scott. You set me up. And then we went into a break and I was like, what's going to happen? What's going to happen? And then you started laughing.
Nah, man, it's been cool, man.
Make that happen, though. Don't wait on that.
Nah. I'm definitely going to make it happen.
All right.
100%.
All right. Who you like Sunday? Who I shouldn't say who you like. Obviously, you don't like either team. Mm-hmm. Who do you believe will win?
The Saints will get Derek Carr.
Between the Chiefs and the Eagles in the Super Bowl.
They play in the Super Bowl?
Mm-hmm. You knew that because you mentioned...
I didn't think they had
You mentioned the Super Bowl halftime show. You knew about Rihanna. You talked about that.
Of course I know about Rihanna.
Yeah.
I think everyone knows about Rihanna.
Sure.
Especially, you know... Look at Rihanna. You can look at it and know about Rihanna. I mean, come on, man.
Why are you getting so like quiet all of a sudden?
I'm not getting quiet.
You're like, man, Rihanna.
Like, it's Rihanna. Like, come on, man.
Yeah.
Like, of course I'll be tuned into Rihanna.
So you're just going to watch halftime and
that's it. I don't want to see anything else.
I did that one time for the Super Bowl a couple years ago, actually.
The one with the
Rams asterisk, yeah. Mm-hmm. Asterisk, yeah. Rams versus Pats. Yeah, I didn't watch that game.
I didn't watch it either.
Came in the next morning. Someone called, like, what do you think about this play? I'm like, I didn't watch it. Like, yeah, right. I'm like, I legit. My wife didn't believe me either. She's like, you really? She thought it was like I was putting it on for like 2 weeks. Yeah. You're really not going to watch it? I'm like, no.
Like, I don't care.
I can't.
Yeah.
I'm not watching this. It's awful.
Now, I'll be honest with you, man. I hope Jalen Hurts does it, man. I really do. I like Jalen Hurts as a person. I
like his story a lot.
I like what he had to overcome as a player. You know what I'm saying? And I hope. I want to hate on Chauncey Garner so bad because he talks about us, you know, in a negative
but
light
we all
sometimes.
Knew that was going to happen.
Yeah, I knew it.
So as soon as he was traded, that was going to happen.
But I like Jalen Hurts, man. I really do. And I hope he pulls it out. That's what I say. I'll be on shift, you know, working.
What would happen if you were on shift and the Saints were in a Super Bowl?
Listen, I would have called in like 3 weeks ahead of time. Because I'd have been like, there's no way I could.
Wouldn't
do
everyone
it.
Be doing the same thing?
No, listen. This is a true story. Like, the no call, when the Saints got the, it was the one seed, right?
Mm-hmm.
When we secured the one seed, I automatically took off for the Super Bowl. Just automatically.
You were just planning ahead.
So I automatically took off.
And then you didn't watch the game.
And now I didn't watch the game.
Yeah.
So I was off. So if that ever happens, trust me, I'll be prepared. I'll be prepared.
All right, man. Well, look forward to hanging out with you. Maybe do a ride-along, something. But this is it for us on the radio. I'm glad You've joined me here last couple years. It's been fun. I know the listeners have enjoyed the heck out of it, and wishing you well, and looking forward to getting a wedding invite one day. Once you finally,
oh yeah, for sure.
Once you finally do what you need to do,
I'm gonna do it, Scott. Like, right. Why are you like? This is not. This is common knowledge, man.
Okay,
like, I'm gonna do it.
All right. I will talk to you guys tomorrow. It'll be the last show. Gus Cattingill will be on for a segment, and then we'll have open phone lines the rest of the way. Have a great Thursday, everybody. What's your Twitter handle? All right, we're out of time. Go follow James Butler on Twitter. It's 103.3 The GOAT, simulcast on 1420.
That's how you're going to end our last session, man?
What is it?
Just talking over me? I'm not saying it because you're going to do that. I'm not doing it.